Let's take a look at the governing equations for constant density flows and then think about how that can be extended to the variable density case. Conservation of mass applied to a vanishingly small chunk of fluid looks like that, del dot v equal to zero. You might have seen that equation before. And remember that this is written in a cylindrical coordinate, so it looks like this. dvz by dz plus dvr by dr plus vr over r equal to zero. Now compare this to the 2D case, which might be more familiar. So that looks like du dx plus dv dy equal to zero. So if you had flow in a channel, we could make the 2D assumption and we could solve this equation. This is one of the few equations I remember from my intro to fluid dynamics back in my undergrad days. So we won't use this version, we'll use this version. Similarly for the other equations. Conservation of momentum, which is really F equal to ma applied to that vanishingly small chunk of fluid in axial and radial directions. And that looks like that. So this term is the acceleration term. So that's the acceleration A. And that's a net pressure force on the little chunk of fluid, and that's a net viscous force. And then you have conservation of energy, which stems from the first law of thermodynamics, and that looks like that. So this term here is the change in internal energy of this small chunk of fluid or vanishingly small chunk of fluid. That's the heat transfer, the net heat transfer out due to conduction. That's a pressure work, and actually this term is zero. I left this term in because it appears for the variable density case too, in which case del dot v is not equal to zero. And that's viscous dissipation, and typically for small, for flows with small velocities like what we have, it's going to be quite small. Okay, so we have four equations. One equation here, this is actually two equations because you have a radial component and an axial component. So you have two scalar equations and you have one equation here. So you have four equations and you have four unknown functions because density is known. So we have four rather than five. So we have four unknown functions. And notice that the energy equation is decoupled from mass and momentum equations, okay? So here you have three equations for mass and momentum, and you have three unknown functions, velocity, and that's two components of velocity and pressure. So I can solve for the constant density case, I can solve mass and momentum separately, and then once I know the velocity field, I can use that to solve conservation of energy. That changes when we go to variable density flows, so let's see what happens there. Conservation of mass looks like that, so now you have del dot rho v equal to zero rather than del dot v because I can't take rho out as a constant. Okay, so that's different. And conservation of momentum looks very similar except that the viscous term is much more complicated. It's still, related to the gradients of the velocity field, and you need to know only one material property, mu, to evaluate those terms. That's a coefficient of viscosity. And conservation of energy looks the same, except that del dot v is now non-zero. So we have five unknown functions now because density now is also an unknown, okay? But we have only four equations, which means we need to bring in one more equation, and that we do through the ideal gas law, rho equals p over rt. And then you make an approximation saying that, you know what? For this pipe, the absolute velocity, absolute pressure is going to change very little within the pipe. So I can use like an average velocity. So that's a user input, and you can say that's equal to the ambient because the absolute pressure is not going to vary very very much from the ambient. So if we use a simplified form of the ideal gas law, and that makes the solution more robust. So that's why we do it. So you get more robustness and a little less work without much loss in accuracy. By the way, that doesn't mean that the gradient of pressure is negligible, okay? It's only the absolute pressure that's negligible, but the net pressure force on a little chunk of fluid can still be non-negligible. And so in influent, you know, for instance, you work in terms of gauge pressure rather than absolute pressure, which you'll see when you get into fluent. Okay, so we have five unknown functions and five equations, four differential equations and one algebraic equation. And the differential equations are nonlinear because you have products of two unknowns, del dot rho v, you know, rho is unknown and v is unknown function and so on. If that's not complicated enough, we have to make it a little bit more complicated, actually quite a bit more complicated, by including the effects of turbulence through Reynolds averaging. Let's take a look at that next.